Hi, everybody. Of course, it's hurricane season. I'm here with Ken Grant, the director of the National Weather Service in Slidell. Of course, June is here. And where do you get June development?
June development in Gulf of Mexico. These are the ones that we're always concerned about because in June, a lot of times we don't have the notice. They'll form in the Gulf of Mexico, and you may only have 48-hour notice before we're impacted.
And where do they go?
Yeah, a lot of these will go over to Texas, and they can come right into Louisiana. So we got to pay attention. Even early in the season, we have to pay attention to these storms.
And then you can also get development right there in the Caribbean.
Yeah, and that's another region that's a hot spot in June. And again, when they develop in the Caribbean, when they develop in the Gulf of Mexico, there's not a lot of notice. And one of the trigger points that we talk about in our education with the parishes, we talk about these big plans that we have. Sometimes we need to shrink those plans because the week-long plan, the two-week plan doesn't
remember Umberto that formed right along the Texas coast?
Go back to Audrey. All of these, actually, there wasn't a lot of notice on some of these storms.
That's exactly it. And the water temperatures in the Gulf and the Caribbean are plenty warm, and there's no El Nino yet. So
exactly. So there's no reason we can't have an early storm. So that's what we got to pay attention. Got to be ready early.
And then you can also get them developing right there over the Bahamas, and they generally tend to curve around that high pressure.
Yeah, they absolutely do. They'll come up along the Atlantic or go back out into the Atlantic. So
you know, there's been a lot of talk about, oh my goodness, have you looked at the models? Do you see something maybe in the Yeah. What do you think of that?
You know, I think if you really look at the models, I mean, there's always something developing. You got to watch it. And it could be a low. It could be nothing. They disappear. The further you go out in time, the less accurate the model. Simple as that. So what happens is we got to avoid fatigue. We got plenty of time to look at these storms. And you just got to be careful not to jump on every cloud out there.
This is something that people really get confused about. And that is the cone that shows where a hurricane or storm could go.
Yeah.
Okay. What's the one-third rule?
Hey, here's the deal. That cone is a cone of error. It's a statistical analysis, a two-thirds error. So if you look at that, one-third of the time, the storm will be on the left side of that track, one-third of the time on the right side, and guess what? One-third of the time, not in the cone at all.
Did you hear that? Not in the cone at all. And in fact, the forecast is getting a little bit better, so the cone is shrinking, and that means that the storm or hurricane can actually be bigger than the cone and the impacts.
Absolutely. It's not a cone of impact. That's what we remind people all the time. It is not a cone of impact. It is a cone of uncertainty. So you get impacts outside the cone. So you got to watch those. Listen to the impacts. That's the critical message every single storm.
Okay. We want to talk about storm surge. Here is a look at Katrina. This is what's incredible about Katrina. Do you remember how the forecast was to take it more over towards Florida? It slowed down. It moved to the southwest, and what didn't happen?
Well, absolutely, and if you think about it, it's all about these steering currents. I mean, we've talked about it all the time, and what's going to steer these storms? Is the trough going to pick it up? Is the ridge going to push it away? That's why we have a cone.
Right.
That's why we have a cone, and it can get outside the cone. That does happen, and it does. And it's all about the size of the storm when you talk about the impacts.
Now, people say, oh, Katrina didn't impact me. I don't need to worry because Katrina was such a monster. All right, this is what you need to see now. This is the track of Isaac. And instead, Katrina, of course, crossed over at Burris, went up towards the Louisiana-Mississippi border. Isaac was a slow mover. It was barely a hurricane.
And huge. Margaret, I mean, look at this system. The average radius of mean maximum wind is about 20 miles. Katrina was 40, unheard of. Isaac, 50. Isaac was a very large storm. And as a result, the impacts are higher.
And people were impacted by Isaac who were not impacted by Katrina. It was a pump pushing water into the Gulf of Mexico.
Yeah, the slower the storm is, the more time there is to push that water into Lake Pontchartrain, into Lake Maurepas, and then around Lake Maurepas, all the parishes, the water pushes into those parishes, piles up. The longer you have winds, the more water piles up. And then, when the winds relax, the water tries to drain, and there's a little point called the Wrigley's. So all that water goes in, and you can't get that much volume of water through the Wrigley's. So what happens is the water piles up, backs up. So some places, like the north shore of Lake Pontchartrain, won't see the highest storm surge for sometimes several days after the hurricane. And that's a point that's it's difficult to understand. It's a slosh, but it's kind of a backup, and then eventually it comes back, and it takes days to get that water out of there.
So this is what you really need to hear, especially Slidell, Mandeville, Covington. You could actually have your highest water 2 days after.
Oh, absolutely.
2 days after. Yeah. That's so important. Here, again, is a look at all of that rain that fell associated with Isaac. And the key here is that it fell on saturated ground.
The big keys here are saturated ground. And if you have an elevated Lake Pontchartrain, an elevated gulf, all that rain falls and it can't drain. You can't push the water into higher water, if that makes sense. So that water drains very slowly, and it piles up, and all your rivers just get higher. It compounds the issue. Slow-moving storms are a nightmare for us.
They really are. But if you have a fast-moving storm, what happens along the Mississippi Gulf Coast?
Yeah, Mississippi Gulf Coast, if you go Harrison County over to Jackson County, a faster storm is a bigger storm surge for those counties. Hancock County is more like Louisiana.
Right.
So it spreads over. We got the lowlands. The water spreads over. They're a little different. It's more like Florida in a sense.
Right.
So the faster storms impact those counties more than the slower ones.
Okay, so the faster storm impacts Harrison and Jackson counties more. The slower storms impact Hancock and Southeast Louisiana more.
Absolutely.
That's real important for you to know. Okay, let's talk about that storm surge. Here is a graphic that kind of shows what happens. And, you know, you can even think of Ike in this case.
Yeah, absolutely. You think of Ike in this case, and Ike, again, was a very large storm. And one thing that I remember Ike, and the biggest frustration that I was having at the time was, you know, you think about Ike being so large, just a Category 2 going to a different state, Texas. It was very hard to communicate that. Ike would produce more storm surge than a direct hit from Gustav. What a concept to be able to communicate, and that's what happened.
And what happens is that you get the water rising. Of course, as a storm develops in the Gulf of Mexico, and with Ike, it moved parallel to the coast, pushed all of that water onshore.
And ahead of the storm. Think about Ike.
Way ahead.
It's such a large storm that there's a storm surge ahead of that storm. So
when
everyone's waiting for the landfall, it's too late. The storm surge is already there.
We need to talk about a big change for the National Hurricane Center.
Yes.
And this is the potential storm surge graphic. This is so important because people are always confused. We say water is going to be 3 to 6 feet above normal, and they're going, well, what is normal?
Yeah.
You're talking about water up to the knees. That's what you're explaining.
This is a game changer, Margaret.
Let's look at this graphic.
Mm-hmm.
And this graphic is going to show big changes. Can you explain it?
Absolutely. This is an absolute game changer here for us, because what this actually shows, this is inundation above ground level. This is water up your leg, so to speak. You ignore the datums, you ignore sea level, you ignore all these different values that can really confuse the whole situation.
And it does. It confuses people every time.
It's hard to get a grasp with that.
I mean, I made a graphic when we had Isaac and said the water's going to be 3 to 6 feet above the ground, and they didn't get it. They said, Margaret, you didn't tell me that I was going to have water in my house. This actually tell you.
And listen to the confidence level that we're looking at this graphic. This graphic here represents about 1,200 runs, bigger, smaller, faster, slower, left, right. We take everything we can and dissect that hurricane and come up with this map. It is a 90% solution. So we have a 90% confidence that the values in this map will be that or less. That's useful. That's a game changer. So there takes a lot of
guesswork.
So
when you look at this graphic and I'm looking at the red, what does that mean?
That red there tells me that at those levels, you match it up to the actual numbers, I could expect that amount of water up my pant leg or above the ground, a 90% confidence at that level or less.
And
that's
the blue?
Valuable. And the blue, the same thing. Match it up. And listen to this. For the Weather Service, for the 142 years, we've always invented our own products, assumed people would just figure it out. That right there, we have social scientists, Margaret. They're in the office. They're helping us develop the colors. They helped us develop that scale, the colors, to make it easy to understand.
Because the whole idea is you want people to understand. You want them to be safe. You want
That's
them
right.
to know this is how high the water is going to be. There is a saying, you hide from the wind, and you run from the water. Water is the biggest killer, isn't it?
It is the biggest killer. Look at the storm surge. We're a huge vulnerability to us, but it's not just the storm surge. Look at Isaac. It's the rainfall that occurs. It's along the rivers. It's the pileup. Water is the biggest killer, and we have to be able to prepare for that. And I think this new tool gives us some sort of way to communicate that in a way that I think everybody can understand, and most importantly, do something.
Do something. Yeah. You have got to. And my feeling has always been you invite people into Jazz Fest, you invite people into Mardi Gras, and then when a hurricane is coming, you go on vacation at their house.
Oh, absolutely.
What are you doing at the National Weather Service office in Slidell? You have done something that's really different. Nowhere else in the country do they do this. What have you done?
We took an old FEMA trailer and converted it to this country's first and only Weather Command Center. So we have converted it. It's amazing. We can deploy. And one thing that our office does that's unique is we deploy. People think of us back behind the scenes in front of a computer doing our thing. We deploy. We're actually deploying meteorologists with the decision makers. Think about all the science. We were talking about it before we started this segment. Uh-huh. All the information that you have to decipher and put together to make a decision is massive. It's just a massive. The more technologies around, the tougher it is, to be honest. There's more information. So we built a trailer. We can deploy. We can get out there. We can get with it. Eyeball to eyeball with the decision makers is the best way to make a decision.
Okay. Let's talk about forecast models. A lot of people say, oh, gee, I looked at the Clipper model and it said it's coming my way.
You know, I have to say this because the physical science is we're getting better and better with where it's going to go, how strong it's going to be. The social science aspect of what we do is getting tougher than ever. So what we have is 10 years ago, Margaret, I would have to put in a password in a computer to get the spaghetti plots, all the different charts and everything. 10 years ago.
Exactly.
Now it's on my app. I mean, I can pull out my phone. It's on my app. So based on
my WDSU app, too.
Exactly. See, there we go. So based on my Myers-Briggs score, based on my personality type, I will pick the track that fits my personality. If I'm a positive person, I'm going to pick the one that goes somewhere else. If I'm a negative person, I'm always going to pick the track that comes here. Think about that. So people they're shopping for the weather. They're making decisions based on their own personality. We're trying to tie that together. You have to be able to look at the information going out there, listen to the officials, and that's what makes the big difference.
That is so important. I've got to tell you, it was great having you here. You've got to come back. There are so many things that I want to talk about. The last message you want to give the public right now.
It's about the impacts. It's not about that category. Please listen to us, listen to the warnings, and watch your favorite TV show. Watch it and listen to the impacts. It's not about that category, and do not ever compare a storm to the last one because every storm is completely different.
That's a look at your hot seat for today.